All right, welcome back, friends. So, today I would like to walk you through a small painting I just finished. And I'm gonna try my best to tell you as much as I can about the painting process, but I would also like to give you a glimpse into the mind of an artist, and maybe even more importantly, what we can take away from it. So this painting is actually a gallery piece. It's my contribution to the annual Moleskine show at Spoke Art. The idea of the show is that every piece on display is painted in a small Moleskine sketchbook. So that's also the reason why I'm using a sketchbook as the painting surface here. Painting in a sketchbook isn't really any different from painting on any other painting surface. And the fact that this is a Moleskine sketchbook also doesn't really matter. You could use any sketchbook to paint on it as long as it's prepared the right way. But the idea of painting in a sketchbook rather than painting on a sheet of paper or a canvas panel is actually pretty interesting and worth considering. It can have some great effects on how we approach things and ultimately what the finished paintings look like. So, since this is basically just like painting on paper, I use the same method that I used in my last video to prepare the painting surface. I primed the paper with a coat of clear acrylic medium or binder and let it dry overnight before painting on it. I have to admit that this can be a bit nerve-wracking, especially when the paper starts warping, and after a few minutes you start to think, what the hell have I done? But if left alone, the paper will relax and it should eventually be level enough to paint on it. I'm mostly using simple flat brushes, but also a few small round brushes to paint some of the smaller features of the face. I'm using oil paints from various different companies, but mostly Rembrandt, Sennelier and Old Holland. And last but not least, as a painting medium, I'm using liquin this time. Now, I have a love-hate relationship with liquin, and the only reason why I'm using it for this painting is that it has one of the quickest drying times. But one thing that most artists don't know or realize about liquin is that it changes the color you mix it in, which is a pretty big deal. It also means that your colors will look different when they dry. This alone can be one of the most annoying and frustrating things ever, especially when you use liquin later in the painting process. But there are also a few other reasons I might get into in a future video why you maybe should think twice before using it. So generally I tend to stay away from it and use safflower oil. But for this painting I needed quick drying times, so liquin was the painting medium of choice. Since this is a really small painting surface and I'm painting a very small face, the painting process is a bit different from my large paintings. Painting at such a small scale doesn't leave me with much room for errors. Every brush stroke I make has a huge impact on the painting, and since it's so easy to mess up the whole painting with one tiny brush stroke, I decided to start by carefully painting one part of the face after another. I start the painting with the darkest parts, which are the shadows under the nose and the areas under the lips and the jaw. After that, I go on to paint all the areas around it, focusing on the lips and the nose. Since I'm painting a profile here, you can't really see too much of the face, so every bit of emotion or expression will have to come from what little you can see. In this case, it's the eye, the nose and the lips that carry the bulk of the emotion and expression. So I take a bit more time than usual to make sure those areas look just like I want them to before I move on to the next parts. What I'm not doing here is finishing an area before I go on to the next. While you certainly could paint everything in one layer, I can't recommend doing that. You miss out on a lot and you always trade off something when you do so. Whether it's vibrancy and texture that come from paint building up in layers, or accuracy and proportions that come from adjusting things each time you repaint an area. All of those things are pretty essential when you try to capture reality in a painting, and I really wouldn't recommend trading them off. Next, I move on to paint the ear, which is probably the second most important feature of this portrait. As in every profile view, the ear is very prominent, so I make sure to get the proportions right from the beginning so I don't run into any problems later in the painting process. After painting the ear, I continue to fill out the rest of the face and the hair, but I'm not really concerned with accuracy at this point, since I will come back to rework some of the areas, and I will also repaint and deconstruct areas of the face later in the painting process anyway. So there's really no need to put too much work into those areas at this stage. For this painting, I'm using my own reference material, and half of the time, or even most of the time, I do so. But I also don't have a problem to use found material if it serves my purpose. I'm all for doing whatever it takes to realize your vision. For example, as I've mentioned before, this is a really small painting surface, and the face that I'm painting is even smaller. So I don't have much room for errors, but I also don't want to be concerned with error correction during the painting process. And that's the reason why I started this painting with a charcoal transfer. which is a great and very useful tool for painting. It doesn't magically do all the work for you, but it also doesn't take away anything from your finished work. It's just a tool. If anyone ever tells you that you shouldn't or can't do that, or anything else for that matter, well, I'm happy to tell you that you are free to not give a shit, because the people saying that usually don't know what they're talking about. There are no rules in creating art. You are free to do whatever works best for you, or like I like to put it, do what's best for the painting. Which isn't always the same. Sometimes it's using a charcoal transfer, but other times it's not using any drawing at all. If you think your art looks better when you use a projector, then you should totally use one. If you think your art is much more vibrant and authentic when you start with a sketch, then by all means go for it. If you think you have to paint over a photo, that's also fine. Anything goes. Do whatever works for you best and helps you realize your visions. What you shouldn't do is listen to all the people out there who have no idea what they're talking about. No one will give you a medal because you spent days on getting your drawing right. No one will give you a medal for anything for that matter. In fact, no one really cares about how you do what you do. For good or for bad, what ultimately counts is what you end up with. And the great thing about creating art is that you can go about doing that in whatever way you like. Now, when it comes to drawing, you should obviously be able to do so, if that's part of the skill set you need to realize your vision. But it's like the skill of cutting for a chef. Yes, you should obviously be able to properly cut with a knife. And of course you can cut a billion onions a day with a knife too. But you know, you can also use a food processor. And there's nothing wrong with that. So I consciously leave out the background until I know that I won't be making any major changes. Instead, I go back to rework some of the areas and I make sure to adjust anything that wasn't quite right on the first pass. I also repaint the hair to give it a bit more volume and I make sure to push the realism a bit more and clean up all the edges. And I do this until I'm more or less happy with everything. And after that, that's where the real painting process begins. I stop painting what I see and I start painting what I know, or feel. I lay in the background and I start to deconstruct areas of the painting by contrasting abstractions and realism. I go back and forth between destroying parts of the painting and repainting them. As you can see, sometimes over and over again until I find the right balance. This is the most intuitive part of my painting process, meaning that I will do these things based on years and years of practice without even thinking about it, and eventually all that's left to do is to clean up some of the edges and make some adjustments here and there. When people think of a painting, chances are that 99% will think of